everybody, very good evening and welcome to the webinar today. I'm Dr. Sravani Reddy. I handle clinical operations for Medvarsity. We have with us today, for today's session, an expert speaker, dietitian Jyoti Chabria. She is somebody with over 28 years of experience in the field of nutrition. She's a very well-known, prominent personality all over our country. She's currently the managing director of Jyoti Wellness and also the CEO of Nutriline. Ma'am, also because today nutrition is so closely interwoven into clinical medicine. Would you agree?
Absolutely.
Yeah, so that is why we have clinicians also showing an interest in nutrition and dietetics. Ma'am, if you have to talk about nutrition, today nutrition and dietetics, first of all, the interesting question would be, what is the difference between the two? Second of all, can you help us understand how nutrition and dietetics has evolved as a specialty in its own? Today it has its own place in healthcare and outside also. Can you please comment on that?
Sure. To begin with, your first question being, what is the difference between nutrition and dietetics? Actually, nutrition is a more advanced, in the sense people who go into research and things are considered as nutritionists. Dietetics is more where you're working with hospitals and clinical part of nutrition. And dieting, you're planning diets for patients and therapeutic use of it.
Yeah.
Now, the thing is about it being more of a holistic approach.
Yeah.
Because it is the mind and the body, as we all know, is connected.
Yeah.
There is nothing that you can segregate. You can't only treat the mind or only the body. And when you treat everything holistically, it makes complete sense.
Yeah.
So today, in the field of nutrition, you have vast opportunities because I do remember when I came in here 25 years ago, even some time back, you know, there was no specialty in itself. And nutrition was not considered a specialty in itself.
Right.
A lot of doctors were doing, you know, probably our job. They used to, you know, kind of tell patients to eat a diabetic, not to eat rice, and more, you know, in very broad spectrums, I would say. But today, nutrition definitely has made a niche for itself, and we do have a specialty in itself because today we have every hospital has a nutritional attached to them.
Right.
The need being that you have diabetic patients and you have, you know, people with acidity and chronic ailments, renal failures. So you definitely need to plan a diet accordingly, according to the health condition, according to age, weight, height, all of that.
Right.
Yeah.
So you are very right about pointing out that it's a holistic approach to managing a disease or an ailment or a patient today. And nutrition has become a very crucial part of it. A lot of healthcare practitioners, including myself as a practitioner, today we all want to add that bit of nutritional advice or dietary advice when we write a prescription. Today no prescription is complete without that nutrition advice or the dietary advice. So ma'am, how different are these two specialties, like nutrition and dietetics? You did define them separately. So a lot of the times what people get confused is with clinical nutrition and nutrition per se. Can you just describe the differences between these?
Sure. Basically, see, when you go to a hospital and you see, I'll just pick up an example to make it clear. For example, if I were to see a diabetic patient, okay, a doctor would probably write a glycomet or something like that, which is an allopathic drug. But apart from the drug, there is a diet which supports the entire thing to make it more holistic.
The nutrition therapy.
Absolutely, the nutrition therapy. So, in fact, today there are a lot of nutraceuticals in the market that have come up, which actually, now it's like, for example, if I were to tell a diabetic patient to have Karela juice every day, because Karela or bitter gourd is known to kind of, you know, help improve insulin resistance and things like that. So probably the patient would come back and tell me, okay, 1 day, 2 days, they've had the Karela juice, and then probably the Karelas are not there, or they don't have the time to go, XYZ, so many reasons come up. So today, if you have a nutraceutical which probably, you know, has everything put together, like Karela, Jamun, Neem, all of that put together in one probably capsule or a tablet, it works far better in terms of patient compliance because it's easier to do.
Mm.
It's not very high on cost. Mm. And it's more workable, I would think. Yeah.
Okay. Okay. So now that we've established that nutrition and dietetics is a specialty in its own, we have people pursuing them as careers and professionals, and this has taken a different turn altogether in the last decade. I'm sure you would agree.
Yes.
Ma'am. So the next thing that we would want to talk about is, if you are somebody who's learning nutrition as a student, or if you're somebody who's practicing nutrition, typically what is the role of a nutritionist? How can a nutritionist play an effective role in the society, be it in healthcare or outside healthcare? What is your role, you would say?
I would think we have a great responsibility here. More about awareness, creating an awareness, because a lot of countries, a lot of people now have taken to nutrition as in I think in a more realistic or a more serious manner.
Right.
Because they've started understanding the importance. Like, just to give you an example, when I used to write in for articles earlier, we had very few people who would come up and ask us that, ma'am, write on this, what is ADHD, what is, and how does nutrition relate to it, correlate to it or whatever. But today we have a lot of people who call me up and they ask me that, ma'am, why don't you write on this? So they are so interested, they are so aware.
More aware, yeah.
And of course, you have access to the internet and whatever. But there are times when people are left a little confused because there's just too much data on the internet.
Yeah.
So, you know, when you go to a healthcare professional and you talk on a one-to-one, I think a lot of your myths are clarified. Like, for example, I had patients who used to ask me in terms of pregnancy. Like, I guess it's even, you know, due to geographic locations or whatever.
Yeah,
like people in different cultures, like in Andhra Pradesh, people would come and ask me that by eating kesar, which is saffron, would you have a fair baby?
Yeah.
Actually, there's no connect. Then lots of patients still today ask me, this is hot, is papaya hot?
Yeah.
You know, mine is a hot body. I never understood that. But
not
there's nothing like, you know, heat and things like that. Because as a dietitian, as a nutritionist, we don't believe in anything as being hot and cold.
Yeah.
You know, so there are so many myths which we clarify today. And okay, to a certain extent, the doctor covers a lot of info for them. But I think as a nutritionist, probably we have a little more time to spend and, you know, really educate them as to what the conditions are and how we can treat it, both with allopathy supported by nutraceuticals.
So what you're clearly saying is, even though there's a lot of data and information available on net today, everybody goes on to the World Wide Web to search for everything today. Patients come to us with diagnosis and medications also. So what you're trying to establish, the key role of a nutritionist is to give them the right perspective.
Absolutely.
And direction.
Yes.
And clarify the confusions and doubts they have. Of course, I think there is another important role that you wouldn't deny and you would want to talk about is the dietary planning and diet counseling. To tell a patient what kind of diet he needs to take and how to plan it. So basically, what, how, when and how much. So would you want to talk about that?
Absolutely. See, one more thing, aspect that I see, a lot of patients have a lot of information today. They've read up, they've heard, they've, you know, studied, whatever. But in terms of what I personally believe is that not one particular diet can be a yardstick or a, you know, a protocol for every patient.
Yeah.
Because it may not work for every patient and every type.
It needs to be customized.
Yes, absolutely. So that's the reason we go in for tailor-made diets. I mean, it's not one pro forma that you follow, every diabetic patient follows this. It's not about, and it's also, like for example, even for weight loss patients, it's not completely about not eating, you know, any kind of oil or any carbohydrate. That, you know, it just becomes a trend that people follow. But every nutrient has its own role to play,
yeah,
is what I personally believe.
Yes, that's a fact.
And like if you say even fats, no diet should be devoid of fat completely, because every role, as I say, every nutrient has its own role to play. So fat is a lubricant in the body. It helps to, you know, disperse all the vitamins in the body to the various cells.
Yeah.
So if you really don't have every quotient in it, the funda is that it has to be eaten in the right proportion.
Right.
For me, as a dietitian, with all my experience, I would say it's not a no-no to eat anything, but it's one, that what is comfortable to you, what works for you, and in balance. That's the most important thing.
Right.
So it's not even alone the diet, exercise, sleep, mind, mental condition, all these come under the holistic condition of, you know, dealing and treating a patient.
So the role of a nutritionist, firstly, to create awareness.
Absolutely.
Give them the right kind of information, filter the things that need to be filtered, and then give them a right way to plan their diet and go about with it. So now that we have established what is the role of a nutritionist, for the sake of our audience and to set the context now exactly right for the discussion today, now a lot of people are nutrition enthusiasts today. That's become a term today. So everybody wants to know something more about nutrition and diet for different reasons. So if you have to talk about who all can pursue a career in nutrition, or who can even think of pursuing a nutrition career, who do you have to say should be doing that?
See, as you rightly said, it's become more of a fad, you know. It's like you follow a dietitian. My dietitian said this. My nutritionist suggested this. And it becomes like a beeline following that person. Another thing is your question about who can become a nutritionist or who can pursue nutrition. I think really someone who has a passion for the subject and who really wants to know about wellness and health and well-being is someone who can pursue it. It doesn't necessarily have to be a BSc background or something. Today you have a lot of short courses which are available. Yeah. There are some 6-month programs and there are 2-year programs.
Online
which can,
programs.
Yes, online yeah. programs, offline programs which can be done. And then you can do probably some internship in some hospitals, because I always believe that hands-on training makes a lot of difference.
Yeah.
So that's where you really actually deal with lives and you know, you realize yeah. how to take it on. But today we have even housewives course. In fact, even I mean, there are a lot of programs that we even do. We do talks in, you know, we do programs for corporates and we do even workshops for other companies where we segment groups,
right.
like whether they are like pregnant ladies or menopausal women or, you know, men out of a certain age group.
Right.
So anyone who really wants to know more on the subject, there are various options today.
Yeah.
You can do crash courses, you can do degree courses, post-graduation courses, all are available.
So, ma'am, you actually summarized the slide we have put up very beautifully, wherein we were talking about who can pursue a career in nutrition. A lot of the times the first choice are the nutrition graduates and people who've come from life science background and things like that. For example, somebody, a medical doctor like me probably would not think of pursuing something in nutrition, but we've clearly established the need for it also today. The second point we put up is anybody with passion for nutrition, I think, can go ahead for it.
Absolutely.
And like you correctly pointed out, today with the kind of schedules and programs that we're already into, whatever profession you're in, if you're really passionate about it, like you said, you can pick up a short course on an online program and try and understand, is that really what you want to do? And if that interests you, probably you can take that forward. If at all we have to talk about what are the different career opportunities that nutrition can offer. Now, the way we want to answer this question is, today nutrition or a nutritionist for that matter can be placed in any segment. There are a lot of segments in the society today. Within healthcare, there are different nutrition groups, different nutritionists that they are. Outside healthcare, there are so many individual run roles and careers that have come up. Just to start the discussion, wellness has become such a boom today. It's getting interwoven into every other industry today. Wellness is part of almost every industry today, and there's no wellness without a nutritionist or a dietitian. So, Dr. Chabria, let's just talk about what are the different career opportunities that nutrition can offer.
See, as you rightly said, when we're talking about courses which can be done by healthcare professionals, as I also said, those who are passionate about it. Like, I have now a lot of mothers, you know, who come to me. I work with schools. So there's one area where we talk to the children, we counsel them for them to understand why we are telling them to eat something. But the people who have to really make it are
mothers,
the moms.
Yeah.
So rather than giving them something like, you know, unhealthy snacks like kurkure or all this junk food, we give them healthier options which are made out of, you know, probably devoid of maida and the refined carbohydrates. So today
right.
you have a lot of options in the market, you know,
yeah,
which
yeah.
are made out of millets and things
yeah,
like that.
Yeah.
So in fact, when you educate the moms, they're so happy to really learn from you and try to do things. Like,
yeah.
just to give you an example, like in one of the schools, I told them to make, just to modify a normal idli that we have in, in the diet, I told them to make it as rainbow idlis, wherein we just added some vegetables and ragi, so we improved the nutritional quotient.
Add color to the idli.
Absolutely. And the child was not used to seeing something like that, so really was,
excited.
Got a kick out of it. And
yeah.
then we made, you know, things like burger. So when I was talking
yeah.
to the kids and they said we'd like to have a burger, the management thought like, what's happened to me? But the fact is that I got a soya cutlet made, a multigrain bread, you know, gluten-free
yeah.
bread made.
Yeah.
And we put it together, garnished it with the same thing with a cherry pineapple and all that. And it looked so attractive and the kids were like, wow. So today we do have in schools, we've incorporated menus using, you know, these healthy options. And even corporates, in fact, because
yeah.
earlier, you know, in the snack time, they would be serving them samosas and kachoris. I mean, what's the point? So now you have fruit
yeah.
options and,
fruit
you know,
bowls.
Healthy juices
yeah.
and things like that.
So wellness, like I said, wellness has gotten into every other industry. If we have to talk about the different career prospects, just to give out some titles and the roles that one can look at, because the audience today would be interested to know, in case they some of them could already be pursuing a nutrition course, some of them today might get their doubts clarified through the discussion and would want to pick up a program in nutrition. At the end of the day, tomorrow they want to know what they can do with it. So the different career prospects, just to add to the discussion, so nutritionist and a dietitian is a very broad term, but today we also have terms like nutritional therapist, health service managers, personal trainers is a huge trend today, community education officers, something part of what you're doing, a food technologist. Now this is something every nutrition website got attached to, a food technologist and health promotion specialist. Tell me, what are all these different titles about, Dr. Chabria?
See, one is the basic nutritionist or a dietitian who's attached to a hospital and doing clinical nutrition.
Clinical nutrition,
but apart, that's clinical nutrition. Now, apart from that, today the avenues are so vast because I myself am associated with a lot of companies where we do food development. You know, we do food formulations.
Okay.
Even Nutriline in itself, in fact, is just a combination of vegetables. And for, like you would see in the market, you have other competitors also, but they would have individual ingredients. But the right combination is what really brings out the best, the efficacy of the product. And so people can pick up, you know, careers where they most of these industries today have, like all, whether it's Safola, whether it's all these companies, oil companies and whatever, they do a lot of to promote their products also, and to even create an awareness, they have nutritionists who devise or formulate recipes, you know, healthy recipes using these things. So one is they get an entry into industries.
Yeah.
Secondly, you have in airline kitchens today, nutritionists are required.
Yeah.
I mean, they're required everywhere, in gyms. Gyms,
there's a
of
kitchen
course.
Everywhere.
Exactly. Yeah. So you have even in old age homes today, nutritionists are required. In the government bodies also, they are appointing nutritionists so that, you know, the food that is served to, because at the end of the day, it's every person, if he's fit, he can perform to his maximum, optimum levels, I would think. So everywhere it really comes in. Yeah. So whether it being an industry, it can be a school. In schools, I mean, there was never an awareness 20 years ago.
Now,
but today, a lot of schools, every school normally has a nutritionist attached.
And a menu.
So that the kids are, you know, eating healthy.
Yeah. Yeah.
Like I just told you an example earlier about those wigglies.
Yeah.
So every school is incorporating. So you have an opportunity in schools, in hospitals, in old age centers, in the community, even NGOs are, you know, working with nutritionists. Like we give Nutriline capsules to the rural villages where, you know, even if we were talking to the lower segment in the rural area, if we can't expect them to buy badams and almonds and things like that, it's too way above there, you know, it's not pocket friendly for them. So this kind of thing, if it reaches out to them, it gives them the, you know, nutrition that they require. And all the hemoglobin things and levels and all are maintained.
One point from your discussion, Dr. Chabria, you spoke about how nutrition has become a very integral part of government programs also.
Absolutely.
We understand that earlier schools were one segment where government was involved with the free meals and everything. You are part of the National Nutrition Society of government. I believe you're part of the advisory board now.
Yes.
Can you talk a little more about how important a role a nutritionist gets to play today in making decisions also, in policy making also, when we talk about these government initiatives?
Well, I think we've come a long way, I would say, that we've really created a niche finally, you know, because today health and wellness is these things. So even the government does give a lot of importance, like even when Mr. Chandrababu Naidu was here so many years ago, he had actually had a team of dietitians wanting to give a lecture and educate the all those delegates who had come here. So the government is understanding the importance of nutrition, especially in villages, that's in schools. So that's why it's becoming almost a mandate now. And now with the government, a lot of changes have happened in their infrastructure and things like that, where they're making it a mandate for nutritionists to be attached to, especially schools, even to the government bodies, even in the army, in all the sectors actually.
Yeah. More so about the maternal and child health also, which
Absolutely.
Is a big thing in the
yes.
government policies.
Because there are a lot of maternal deaths, the incidence of maternal deaths is huge initially. So we are trying to slowly bridge that gap.
Right,
yeah?
Right. So now that we've spoken about nutrition as a career in an industry, there are different roles that a nutritionist can play today. But since you are an entrepreneur yourself and you've done that with nutrition, a lot of the times it becomes difficult to connect nutrition with entrepreneurship. Can you talk about that? How can nutrition be an entrepreneurship option today?
Well, really speaking, where I'm concerned, I would say I've lived my dream. Because I have really, really toiled over this, but I have really tried to make a significant impact on people. Because, see, all the time, availability of various foods, as I said earlier, is not always there. And to dish up, I mean, you have working mothers today, you have working women, they don't have that much time. So these quick fix methods make it much easier. Like even Nutriline capsules are being used by school children, though they are capsules, so not everyone can swallow them. So these little kids, what they are doing, the parents, they are just opening this and mixing it into their dal or their rotis, and all their, you know, vegetables as in spinach and whatever we've used is going into them. Another thing that we rampantly see today is a D3 and B12 deficiency. I'm sure you'll agree.
Yeah, yeah, of course.
Every patient that you see, I mean, almost every patient that you see is deficient of D3, B12, which affects almost every part of the body.
Yeah.
Today, be it skin, hair, fertility, bones, everything.
Yeah.
Bones. And so when you supplement the nutrition part with something like this, I mean, you're taking care of a lot of things which, you know, probably a person can't be doing on a day-to-day basis every 2 hours to keep recreating. Everyone does not have the time.
Right.
So this definitely holds a lot of weight and is a quick fix method, a easy method. It's not, it does not have any, you know, as long as things don't have any side effects or they don't have any allergies to food, they're good to go with all of these.
So what you've basically gotten yourself to do is nutraceuticals, that's what you mean.
Absolutely.
Wherein developing different kinds of foods and short fixes, like you said. If in general people want to take up nutrition as an entrepreneurship option, what are different things that they can do? Nutraceuticals, of course, we've established with you and Nutriline. How else can they venture into entrepreneurship with a nutrition background?
You can do, with a nutrition background, one can, as you said, food technology is also, food science is one of the subjects of nutrition, one of our major papers.
Yeah, yeah.
And having a knowledge of food, basically per se, you can formulate a lot of, products which are healthy in terms of not using the refined carbohydrates like maida and sugar and things like that.
Yeah.
And you can make things out of millets. And as you see today, there's so much of demand and there's so much people creating detox teas. And, you know, nutrition is a vast, vast ocean, actually.
Yeah.
So if you look at the segment of people today into entrepreneurship using nutrition as a background, it's amazing. People have come into herbal teas and they've got into cookies and millets and I mean, actually millets and all were used way before even here. It's all Indian food. It's our roots actually.
Yeah.
So basically we are getting back to our roots, but using the, you know, understanding the nutrition significance of.
And you think there is an entrepreneurship option there?
Absolutely, because there is a lot of demand.
Yeah.
It's all based on demand and supply, in fact. And today people are aware, so there is a lot of opportunity to, you know, create different food formulations, baby food formulations for the senior people, geriatric, and another thing is the bariatric nutrition that is coming in.
Yeah.
Bariatric surgeries are so common today.
Yeah.
So now, I'm not very sure if this audience knows, but bariatrics is when they are not able to eat initially after the surgery, post-surgery, they're absolutely not able to eat.
Yeah.
So these kind of nutrition fixes really work for them because they are able to get up much faster, which otherwise would probably take them 2 months to do, they're doing it in 15, 20 days.
Yeah. Just to add to that, there is a relevant question in the chat box. There is Rupa Sharma who says she is an MBA and she has done a fellowship in applied nutrition course with us at Medvarsity. Now want to make a career out of it. How can I go ahead further? Please advise. So she's an MBA who did a nutrition program with us. So she's looking at ideas. I'm sure she can pick up from your earlier conversation also, but anything specifically to Rupa, what she can do to take it forward?
Absolutely. What I first feel is that if she's clear with what kind of a blueprint she wants to make, as in whether she wants to go in for a health product, as in a food supplement, or she wants to go for a nutraceutical, you need to be clear on what you want to do. Whether you want to, you know, work around food, you want to work around a nutraceutical capsule or a tablet, you want to work around a protein powder. And once you have, you know, you try to work around those and have more clarity on that, then you can probably, you know, work it out as in making a blueprint and just saying, okay, this is what I want to do and I would need these kind of ingredients or this kind of a setup to do it. And today there are a lot of companies who even help you to do it, you know.
Yeah,
like
yeah.
like I work with different, I do formulations for different companies. Likewise, there are many companies, there are many people who have their own expertise in various fields. So you can join hands with them and take it on.
Yeah. I think to add to that, what Rupa needs to firstly decide is if she's interested in the clinical nutrition side or the non-clinical nutrition side. And then probably go ahead with the choices that you've mentioned. We'll take another question before we go on. There is Sharif on the chat box who's asking, I'm currently certified sports nutrition and I want to work as an online health coach. How can this be done? So he's talking about working with online websites who work with clients, so where you can be a health coach there. So as a certified sports nutritionist, how can he take it forward?
Today you have a lot of platforms online, you know, who are looking for people, who are looking for experts to join them, so that they could help people like these who want to take it on further and create a team.
Yeah.
So there are a lot of companies who do this in terms of digital marketing. It's become a very big thing today. Online presence is very, very stark and significant.
Absolutely.
Today. So he could probably tie up with one of the companies like that and take it on.
Right. Rupa says that she wants, since we've discussed about differentiating clinical and non-clinical, she says she wants to take up clinical nutrition. I think, Rupa, what you need to do is, you said you've done a fellowship in applied nutrition and you are a business management graduate, MBA. Like Dr. Chabria also pointed out earlier in the discussion, if you're getting into clinical nutrition, I think it's very, very important to take another advanced program and meanwhile parallelly also get some internship done at a hospital.
Absolutely.
Or a healthcare setup, wherein you get to interact with the patient system there, understand what typically goes on in a day in a clinical nutritionist role, and then probably take it forward from there. So my suggestion would be, take up the next level program in clinical, I'm just giving an example, there's a fellowship in clinical nutrition program that we do also. So I'm not just saying that one program, pick up something more clinical. Probably, take some time out and get attached to a hospital or a dietitian. Understand how it works in the healthcare setup and take it forward probably. Yeah, that should be the ideal thing to do. Now that we've established, there are various career paths that, a nutrition enthusiast can take forward. And we've spoken about entrepreneurship as well. The entire discussion or the context today to having you here also, Dr. Chabria, is to collaborate and help them understand how you've added the inputs from your end. The idea is how Medvarsity can help them take this forward, or how can Medvarsity help them, if they've gotten their doubts clarified today from your discussion, what is their next step and how can we play a role? So we have two programs on nutrition and dietetics. So Medvarsity has been there for 18 years in the industry, in the healthcare. We've done a lot of, we've meddled with different kinds of programs around nutrition, and there are two core programs on nutrition that we do, like I said. There is a masterclass in dietetics and nutrition wherein it's layered into three levels, level one, level two, and level three. The level one is more of basic sciences, more about nutrition, proteins, vitamins, and different elements in it. Level two is a little advanced dietetics concept. Level 3, again, clinical nutrition involved in it. So each level is for 3 months of duration. And each level is to help the audience understand which way they want to go. Like, for example, level 1, anybody can pick up and take it up. You could be a lawyer, you could be a management grad. Anybody can pick up, understand the basics, right? Like you said, today everybody needs to know the basics of nutrition. And there's so much data that's available on web. It becomes very confusing and scary also at times.
Yes.
So since we put in a lot of effort to bring in experts like you and content builders who've built the content, I think somebody can pick up a basic certificate level program, the level one program. And then if that is what they really want to do and go ahead and, make a career out of it, probably take the next level of course, and then probably take up the next level if you want to get into clinical nutrition. So that's one program. You can definitely look at Masterclass in Nutrition and Dietetics. And the other program, Dr. Chabria, like I said, if somebody like me, a medical professional, wants to pick up a nutrition course. Now, see, first of all, it's a very tough decision to make. Should I even need a nutrition course to add to my... Somebody like me who's been looking into all these details, I know that I do need it to add to my prescription. I would probably pick up the second program that we do, which is a fellowship in clinical nutrition, because the basics of nutrition and the next level is something we've covered in our MBBS also. But clinical nutrition, wherein there is different system-wise nutrition requirements that are being dealt with. You would agree today in healthcare, we have onco-nutrition yes. separately. Like you mentioned, bariatric nutrition is one thing. Pediatric nutrition is another yes. thing. So there are and lifestyle diseases. Disease-specific nutrition has become so popular. Diabetic diets, hypertensive diets. So probably as a clinician or somebody from clinical background, that's what I would want to do. So for all those who would want to pick up just the clinical nutrition part, you can pick up the fellowship in clinical nutrition also. That's a 6-month program, very comprehensively made with expert talks and videos with experts like you. So these are the two programs that we have at Medvarsity. The idea is for our audience today, through you help them understand, make a decision what nutrition can offer. Two is to connect it with how Medvarsity can help them. You know, like you mentioned, they can pick up an online program and take it forward. So both of these are completely online. To add to the suggestion you gave that they should have some internship attached, we have a 2 weeks optional internship option at our training hospitals, wherein these students can apply to us and come join for an internship, work with the registered dietitians there if they're looking at a clinical nutrition right. program, understand how it is done in the healthcare. Would you agree, Dr. Chabria, that the clinical internship would add value to that clinical nutrition? What do you want to say to the audience about that, about the internship?
Yes, I definitely would say that would add value, because as I always believe, hands-on is a different experience altogether. Because when you really meet a patient in a hospital versus just a theory that you're reading in a book, or, it's one personal connect. And you pick up a lot of parameters from the body language of the patient. Now, it's like, for example, if you were to see an 80-year-old patient and he's diabetic, obviously, I would not have those kind of restrictions that I would probably give someone at 30 or 40, where life yeah. is so, you know.
Yeah.
So, obviously, you deal with the patient as per the age, and even a lot of psyche goes into it as you're yeah, planning yeah. a diet or whatever. It's not that there's so many children who come to us and, you know, the parents say, no, she's not going to do it. But the minute we show some trust in the patient himself or herself, the battle's won, because she's done what you've told her and she's come back losing all that weight or whatever her issues were corrected. And it's almost to tell the parents, look, I've done it, you know. So yeah. it's very important to have that. That internship is very important, because I feel it adds great value to the course.
Yeah, especially for those who want to get into clinical nutrition and understand.
Especially in clinical nutrition.
Yeah, right. Because like you rightly mentioned, Dr. Chabria, a diet plan does not work the same way with every patient, because each one is different in all the terms, age, gender, other comorbid conditions that they might have. So they need to understand how they need to customize the plan for each patient.
Yes.
And I think that can only happen when they look at a variety of patients, and that's only possible through an internship.
Yes.
So yeah, we have that added advantage. Dr. Chabria, we'll take another question. There is Vinay in the chat box. Hi, Vinay. Vinay is a yoga teacher. I'll let you answer this question. So he's asking, so you've seen the two courses that we offer. Vinay is a yoga teacher. He's asking which course is good for me. If he needs to pick up a nutrition program, what he should be doing?
I think the fellowship program should be good for him.
Because you think his basics in nutrition
should already be covered. Be strong, yes, absolutely.
Yeah. Okay. There is Kapil in the chat box. Hi, Kapil. So I'll take this question. So he's asking about, since it is a masterclass, what about recognition? Kapil, this is not a master's program. If you look at the slide, let me go back to the course page. Can we have masterclass course page? Yeah. It's called Masterclass in Nutrition and Dietetics. We're not calling it a master's program, because a master's program is a 3-year comprehensive program at a university level. That's how it's done anywhere. So these are programs which have been built in to help professionals like you and me. Like, we're talking about a yoga teacher in the chat box. There's an MBA in the chat box. And people like me who are practicing clinicians. These programs have been designed to help people like us to pick up something online and add value to our existing practices. And if at all we want to take that forward as a career, like nutrition as a career, then probably go forward and take up an advanced program and do an internship to add value to it. So to answer your question, Kapil, it's not a master's program. It's a masterclass in nutrition and dietetics. So, yeah. Hi, Dr. Gayatri. There's Dr. Gayatri in the chat box.
Hi.
I'm a homeopathic physician. Can I go for a fellowship program? Well, Dr. Chabria, so there are a lot of alternate medicine doctors who do treat a lot of patients on day-to-day basis. Can you talk a little bit about how can a knowledge on nutrition add value to their practice as well?
I would think that it would definitely add a lot of value. Reason being, you would even know what kind of, if they are allergic to any food or something that will work for them. Like, for example, if you're even a homeopathy doctor and you're treating a diabetic patient, if you guide them along with whatever your diet, see, sometimes in these way, alternate medicines, there are certain food restrictions that, the doctors tell you don't have this or don't have that. So if you have a little more insight on the subject in terms of nutrition, I think you can make a better choice amongst the foods that you're advising them to take.
I think it all boils down to nutrition is something that can add value to every prescription, I would say, whichever medicine you're practicing, because nutrition is part of every medicine. It is there in every medicine. Like, I might be prescribing an allopathic drug. Somebody else could be prescribing a homeopathic drug or whatever capsule. But at the end of it, nutrition is something that is basis for everything. So, so it definitely it should add value. And the program you should be looking at again, to go back to the chat box for Gayatri. Can I go for a fellowship program? Yes, you can go for a fellowship program and take that forward. Yeah. Okay, there's somebody... Percival wants to know, shall you be able to download? Yes, you will be able to not download, but you can view the webinar later on. That's not at all a problem. Dr. Chabria, to take the discussion forward. Now, we've understood what kind of audience we've had. They've had their share of questions and we've shared what courses we can offer also. Let's run a poll and see to understand. This is like a call to action. So let's see how many of the audience today has understood the discussion we've had or clarified their doubts, and how many of them want to pick up a program. So there's a poll we're running out of the two courses. Which one makes sense to you and which one would you want to pick up and go forward? So that's the poll we are running now. So we'll be able to see the answers. So 80% of the audience is saying masterclass in nutrition and dietetics. 71 now. 29% is saying fellowship in clinical nutrition.
Okay.
So this is an expected percentage division, because a lot of the times nutrition is from a broader perspective, and very few of them would want to channelize into clinical nutrition. So that's fair enough. Okay, now it's 58% masterclass and 42% clinical also. Okay, that's interesting. Thanks for responding, guys. So we understand what courses that you're interested in. So if you want to pick up a program and take your career forward and get into all those exciting opportunities that Dr. Chabria has mentioned, and you should be reaching out to us. There is a contact details that are mentioned on the slide. You have a WhatsApp number, a toll-free number, and an email ID as well. For more details, you can log on to www.medvarsity.com and you can take your initiative forward. If you have, we want to take some time for Q&A. So Dr. Chabria is here with us. If there's anybody who wants to ask specific questions on how you can take your nutrition career forward, so this is the time and opportunity. So please post your questions and we'll take this forward. And before somebody posts a question, may I ask you one? There are different diets today with fancy names, and each season there is a new diet which gets popular. Okay, to just add to the current scenario, keto is going big time right now, isn't it?
Absolutely.
So there are different diets. We've seen different kinds of diets. You know, they just come up everywhere suddenly. You've made one right point wherein same diet cannot work for everybody, and you can't use the same diet plan for everybody. So is how true are these? Do these magic diets really work, or should it be a properly planned diet as per an individual that you need to follow? Can you please comment and answer the $1 million question today?
Sure. Actually, this is a hot favorite question that keeps coming up. The keto diet is the thing today, and everyone wants to do the keto diet. Very many people do not know really what it's all about. It's more about losing oodles of weight very fast. Well, all these GMO, Atkinson's are the ones we used to hear earlier, or this intermittent fasting is a program I had done recently with one of these fit festivals. And these fads keep coming in, actually. According to me, they're fads. They're okay as starters.
Yeah.
They're okay as starters, maybe to motivate you, but in the long run, they don't sustain.
It's
what
not
I
sustainable.
Always, I
yeah,
would
yeah.
feel that it's more practical to do something that is more balanced, that works for you. As I write, again, I'm reiterating the same thing. The same diet may not work for two people.
Yeah.
Because it all varies according to their body type and you know, so many factors.
The comorbidities that
absolutely.
They have.
Absolutely. Yeah. So one could be diabetic with a sugar level of like 300 plus. One could be a diabetic with a sugar reading of 120. You obviously will not have the same kind of restrictions for the two.
Yeah.
So I would like to summarize by saying that every diet should be customized, one.
Okay.
They taking into consideration all the parameters of the patient or of the person. And yeah, if your question was, what about all these diets that have come up? They are all fads according to me. They are okay to do it for starters, but they are not sustainable in the long run and should not be. Especially I have seen a lot of patients who are diabetic who are following the keto diet on and on.
I have seen a lot of patients as well.
Which
yeah.
Scares me actually to a certain extent.
Yeah.
Because you do it for a week, 10 days, fine. But
it's not
sustainable. You've seen a lot of patients with getting into hypoglycemias and coming back.
Yeah.
So how does that work actually?
Yeah.
So rather do something that is more sustainable, that is more holistic, and you know, where you get your results which are consistent.
Yeah.
Even though it could be a slow process, but
yeah,
it makes more sense to me.
So bottom line is magic diets do work, but they're not sustainable.
Not sustainable.
That's the word. So I think, like I said, today dietary need for dietary advice is a part of every family, every organization, A family is the smallest unit that we can think of. It starts at home. I think corely to understand how to customize a diet plan and which diet will work for which patient or person is the clarity that all of us need to get. And the data that's available on net is not going to help us with that. Probably the ideal way is to pick up a basic program, understand how diets are customized and how dietary planning is done, how dietary counseling is done. To all of our attendees today, be it clinical or non-clinical, whenever you're seeing a patient or a customer of yours, I think the crucial thing to understand is how to customize it for that person.
Absolutely.
And to differentiate myths from facts, I think the only way to go ahead is, like they say, you need to understand what the core principles of dietary counseling is and planning is done. So I think that's the ideal way to go about. Dr. Chabria also agrees with that. So she's made the statement, diets are magical, they do work, but they're not sustainable. So for the benefit of us and our patients or the institutions that we work for, we need to get that clarity, and one way is to pick up a program and do. Medvarsity can help you take that decision. So think about it. We've tried to answer as many questions as possible. If you still have questions, we have some time. So, Mumtaz is on the chat box. Hi, Mumtaz. Hello there. I want to ask that after doing masterclass, what kind of opportunities we get? Dr. Chabria, I'd let you answer this. So she's saying she wants to pick up our online program, the 3-level program. She's saying what kind of opportunities that she can look at after that. Can you answer for all of them? If somebody picks up an online nutrition and dietetics program, how can they take that forward? What is the next step for them?
They could apply in any industry. They could apply in a food, company dealing with food. They could work with schools. The same platform goes everywhere. I mean, once you do a program in nutrition, of course, you should do the more advanced program so that you know more as you deepen your knowledge.
Yeah.
But you do have avenues to various channels like schools and corporates and gyms and things like
that. There's one favorite question of mine I end up asking every speaker that we have. Is this a myth that e-learning is not same as the usual traditional learning, or do you want to contradict that statement? Does e-learning help advance careers and professions?
It does. I would not, now that you have technology and it's become so much easier for people to, rather than not doing something, it always adds value. So doing all these programs that you all have to offer definitely gives them opportunities for a career, to make it a good career.
It adds value to what you're doing today, and it can help you make that decision to take that step forward.
Absolutely.
To understand if this is your passion and if this is what you want to do. I think picking up an online program is the easiest thing to do, to try and test yourself and your passion also. So we all hope that our discussion today with Dr. Chabria helped you make that decision. Like I said, if you want to take this initiative forward, please contact us on the details given to you. We'll come back and join you guys in another interesting discussion with another exciting speaker. Thank you so much, Dr. Chabria, for joining us today. It was a pleasure having you. Any parting note or message for the audience?
Yeah, as we were just saying, like what you rightly said, Dr. Sravani, is that if they do this program, which is a little, maybe comprehensive, short course, at least they understand if they want to do it. Supposing I take up a degree course, or you know, I'm stuck in college for 3, 4, 5 years, and I realize that this is not my cup of tea. Mm. You don't know whether you should finish that degree or give it up in the middle, or you know, be a college dropout or whatever. So doing this, at least it gives you a avenue to understand, is this where I want to go?
Yeah.
And it's so interesting a subject that I'm sure someone who joins the program would not want to stop it at that.
Thank you so much for saying that, Dr. Chabria. It was wonderful having you today. And that's all from us now. We'll join you guys for another interesting session another time. Bye-bye.